actually meditations really bring me to into this monastic life. And because before I started to meditate, all I know is the happiness is come from the senses. You know, try to get the good food, best dress, you know, try very hard, you know. But it's not fulfilling. It's just like, you know, you never fulfill. It's just always empty. But only when I started to meditate, then I have experienced the other type of happiness. The happiness that not rely on the senses, the happiness that within myself. And actually, after I have experienced this inner peace and inner happiness, then I realized that this is the happiness that I really, that is worth pursuing, and I find that is more satisfaction compared to what the happiness that, you know, from the senses. Then I started to like practice more and doing more retreat, and I started to stay in the monastery, like spend more time in the monastery. And I really enjoy staying in the monastery, and I really feel like more at home, like I come back home and this is my home. And I feel really at ease and at peace staying in the monastery. And actually I really enjoy like staying in the monastery. Then after a while I started to look at, like, you know, since you know, I have to live until I die. So what sort of lifestyle that I want to live? You know, do I want to live a life, you know, in the monastery, a peaceful life, or to continue the life in the world? So I decided to live this life. When I decided, my son was 18. Of course, when he was 18, and this is how, as a mother, you still attach. I still have the attachment towards my son, and I give myself all sorts of reason that, you know, he still need me. You know, maybe, you know. You know, on one hand, theoretically, we know, you know, but on the other hand, it's just non-self, like, you know, you just can't let go. That's you. This is my son. He's part of me. He's me and mine, and my only son. So I realized that, hang on a minute, and I give myself the reason that he still need me because he's only 18. But I just look at myself as, hang on a minute, actually, it's not my son attached to me. Actually, I am attached to him. But I give myself the reason that he needs me. Actually, he doesn't. So actually, when I told him about what I intend to do, and he said to me, Mom, you know, I'm fine. I'm grown up. You know, not to worry about me. If that really makes you happy, then you do that. You know, I'm old enough to look after myself, because I've been training him since he was young to be independent, to look after himself, because I know that I'm not always there for him. So what happens if I die? If I make him too independent of me, rely on me too much? So, but of course, initially, is to make that decision to leave him when he was 18. Actually, it's a quite a painful decision. It's just like the cutting part of the flesh out from your body, the kind of pain, you know. That's why I can comprehend, I can understand how a mother feels like when they're separated from the child. And I have that feeling. But I realize that, you know, no matter how much I love my son, but ultimately, he's just another individual. He had his life, and he has his own karma, and I he can't really make me happy, and he can't really bring me happiness, and only myself, like, to pursue this path that only I myself that can bring myself happiness. It's not things outside. So to look for the happiness within myself is not try to get the happiness from the outside object, because that is, you can't control. And this is how I started. actually is quite a difficult thing, especially as you know, especially in Theravada traditions, there is no place for training, place or none. So I've been looking, searching, even though I was really ready to become a nun, but it's not easy. So of course, at the beginning, I traveled to Thailand. I spent some time in different monasteries. And I spent some time with some meditation to in a nunnery. And I remember the first visit when I arrived there. I wasn't quite happy. I was quite very judgmental because I was really, because I had expectations that, you know, this is a Buddhist country, there's no Dhamma. But when I stayed in this nunnery, they're not really, they're quite superstitious, like for example, like someone, like the bad luck. So they will say, okay, since you try to change your luck, so you become a meiji for 2 weeks, then you will change your luck, you know. And even they have to look for the day, a good day to ordain as a meiji, and a good day to destroy, and this sort of things. And I wasn't quite, used to that, and because of that high expectation. And I really was thinking, no, I'm not going to stay here. It's not the place that I want to practice. And I just very dissatisfied. And this is how the mind, the fault-finding mind, you start to look at the things that is, you know, I know. But when you have that fault-finding mind, you can find fault with everything. So, for example, in the morning, like at 3 o'clock, they started to chanting and meditate. And I find that, oh, it's terrible. And the chanting is horrible. And it's, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning, and you know, it's so sleepy. And the way they chant is so slow. Like, you know, like running out of battery, you know. They are lovely. This is how you relate to relationship, to relate. Because we can, you know, take it for granted, complain all the time, go on and on and on and on. But as I started to change my attitude towards, you know, my relationship, towards the people that is there, and I started to find that, yeah, it's fine. Actually, it's none of my business what they do, whether they're speakers, teachers, you know. But they're all lovely, they're all kind people. And I started to rather to look at, you know, to look at the good things. I realized that when you focus on the good things grow, that quality grow. And I ended up, actually, I want to leave, but I stayed there longer. I stayed there for 1.5 months before I move on to the north, because I tried to travel to look at different monasteries. And after that, I still, actually, I did go back a couple of times. And the last time I went back, I went with my son. We spent a few days there. My son, I spent a month there, but my son spent a few days there. We had a retreat there. So he was happy too. I was quite happy to have the opportunities to spend some time with my son in the monastery. So then I was invited to become a meiji in this nunnery, but I just don't really want to become a meiji, because I just want to live a monastic life, to really, you know, to live in a seclusion, like, you know, just a monastic life. And then I started to travel to other places. Then I just realized that it's so difficult being a woman to hide in the monastic life. Then I started to complain, and I always used to make an aspiration that, you know, I tell myself, okay, each time I meditate, before I meditate, I make an aspiration. Next time, I'm not going to be reborn as a woman. Because it's difficult. After finish my meditations, I make an aspiration too, you know, make sure that next life I'm not going to be reborn as a woman, because I just, you know, it's so easy. If I were a man, I'm already a monk long ago. But because I am a woman, you know, so is that, you know, that's going on. Until I was staying in one of the monasteries. Until one day that really struck me, that I was really woke up to that. I went out the monastery to the town to get a ticket. I want to go back to my family, to see my family. And as I walked past, there was a group of men that gambling and taking alcohol, a beer. And I look at that, and that moment like just struck me, that moment. I started to ask myself, I don't want to become a man. You know? I don't want to become a man like them, you know? Like, so, and actually, that insight arises that moment. That, and I said, and asked myself, actually, it doesn't it doesn't matter anymore whether you're a man or a woman. To me, it's because sometimes we tend to take it for granted, and we are not appreciating what we have, you know, right now. So I ask myself, like, I have this human body, I have the opportunities to listen to the Dhamma, and be able to practice. And then I'm not being appreciative, I'm not grateful what I have, and I start looking at that, the things that I don't have. And actually, it doesn't matter whether I'm a man or a woman. So if I were to be born as a man, but, you know, not practicing like that, so I'm quite happy that the fact that I'm a woman. So actually since then, I stopped making the aspirations not to become born as a man anymore. Actually, I started to look at, oh, actually, it's not too bad. You know, female practitioners, you know, and, you know, actually, it's like, sometimes I look at the monks, young monks, especially when I was living, staying at Wat Pa Narachat, and a lot of young monks. And, you know, in Thailand, being a monk is something novel. So being a nun as a meiji is a failure. you know, be old, or you know, you can't get a husband, or you know, no one wants you, you know, they can't bury you off, or you're sick, you're old, you become a nun. And this is how the perception of being a nun is to have very low self-esteem. But I find that, and I look at also the suffering of men too, you know, like this monk actually, because of it's something normal, and they've been looked up, and they constantly have to put up, you know, and expectations, have to live up to the expectations, you know. Then I really find that I'm more at ease and at peace. I'm always the top of the line, you know. And actually, I find that it's quite, then I realize that, yeah, actually, isn't it good being a female? And I, you know, like, I can cry, I don't have to be a tough guy, you know, I can be girly, you know, okay, you know. And I started to see that there's still some advantages being a female. Actually, this is how we develop the perceptions, like how we look at things. So actually, it's not really what we're experiencing and what is really important. And really, how we experience it, how we relate to it. Actually, this is to my experience that, you know, that very important, when we suffer, we really have to know where is the suffering come from. But each time when I investigate, it's nothing outside the sense of self. You know, me and mine, you know, holding on to our own views and opinions, you know. And this is how I started. And yeah, then I remember I met Pandya Sujato after that, you know, when I was in Nepal. And he told me that, you know, there was a nun's monastery in Australia. And that time says, they just bought the land and nothing yet. So I wrote in, you know. And actually, so I lived for quite a few years to be able to ordain because they haven't had anything yet, you know. So I wrote to Ajahn Mayama. So we have been like really communicating through, you know, I write it to her, to each other, and telling her that I would like to become a nun. This is what I would like to live my life. This, and I waited, and eventually I got my visas and to live in, to practice and become a nun there. And initially, so I just, to me, like, to me, it doesn't matter. I just want to, I love that kind of simplicity. I love those forests. I like that kind of lifestyle. And I had the passion and enjoying that kind of lifestyle. And this is why I made the decision to become a nun. So to me, it doesn't matter whether it's, whether I'm a bhikkhuni or not. Actually, to me, it doesn't matter. So I take up the training. So 2 years as an anatharika sakling. Then after that, I become a precept nuns for 4 years. Then after that, we have the opportunities to take up the bhikkhuni ordination. To me, I personally, I don't mind whether it's like precepts or bhikkhuni. But because I was thinking that one of the reasons I changed my mind that I decided to take up, because when Ajahn Brahm asked us, is it that, you know, because he's very open, you know, he said, if this is what you all would love, you take up, you support. And he's a very, very compassionate and kind and gentleman, you know, he's very, very supportive of the nuns. Remember the last time when I visited my family that is in the year 2000, before the bhikkhuni ordination, at the beginning of 2009. And I went to a monastery, I met a monk. So, because in Dhammasara, even though we are getting precepts, but actually we keep a lot of rules, extra rules. For example, we only normally we don't cook, and we don't take food when this is not offered. Like we make sure that the lay people come and offer us. So we rather, if that they don't want to come and offer us food, we rather not to have food. So that make sure that they come to support us. Even though actually it's not, it's, we are not a bhikkhuni, actually we don't have to. But because of we create that conditions so that we got the support. So that because to us, like, if being a bhikkhuni, we not be able to uphold the rules, what's the point to take up the ordination? So this is one of the reason why we have this practice. So even though we've been practicing, we keep a lot of those bhikkhuni's rules, but it's not informally, it's not formally a bhikkhuni. So I mean, you know, so I usually just take things that is offered, it's not offered, I don't take it. So when I was living in one of these monastery, this monk told me, he tried to explain to me that, you know, you are a samanari, you know, you are thankful. He said, you don't have to offer it, you know. Then I just feel like, you know, on one hand, they said, it doesn't matter, you know, that's, you know, thankful is just enough. And on other hand, you can keep it in your heart. So, you know, and on other hand, when I keep it in my heart, and they said, oh, you don't have to keep it, you know. I mean, I just find that, you know, this is contradict. And I realized that it's not a sort of complication. For example, for a monk, you're either a monk or not a monk. You're either a bhikkhu or not a bhikkhu. And for a female monastic, we have all this neji, we have all this what, samanari, tenkris, silamata, you know, and siale, you know, those eight precepts, nuns, you know, different traditions. And a lot of lay people are just confused.
Yes.
So to me is that you're either a nun or not a nun. So why make it so complicated? So why not just say bhikkhu and bhikkhuni? And this is what initiated by the Buddha. The Buddha never initiated neji. The Buddha never initiated ten precepts nuns, silamata. He's never. He's either a bhikkhu or bhikkhuni. So then I realized that okay, because of that, you know. Because I was thinking it's fine, I keep it, you know, in my heart. But people think that I'm just ridiculous. It's just like an example. If a lay people, you know, you think that it doesn't matter, you know, I'm a lay people, but I want to keep all these bhikkhuni rule, 311 rules. Isn't it people would think that they're crazy? Just, you know, this is how, you know. And then I realized that actually we do it, it's not only for ourselves. It's for many, many after us, you know. You just imagine, it's confusing, you know. A nun, 8 precepts, 10 precepts, and maybe come up to no precepts. Yeah. You know, people can just shake their head, you know, I'm a nun, you know. So then actually it's not only for ourselves to prolong the sasana, the Buddha sasana, because the Buddha said, you know, you have to be here. You have the Dhamma, you have the Dhamma, you have the Vinaya. So keeping the precepts is important. So, and this is how I decided to become a bhikkhuni. So is it time up to start the talk?
Yes,
but the talk is getting interesting.
This is the talk.
It is at 30. It is.
The real view.
You want to start now or we can continue with the topic?
Start with the topic.
Maybe you can raise some questions.
Yeah.
I like the questions because it's challenging.
I mean, so far, I'm so touched what I heard. It almost brought me to tears because 311. It's so hard. I can't even follow. Same as bhikkhuni, giving 311 rules.
Yeah,
more than the monks.
Yeah,
because the monk, you're not kidding. Because the Buddha never set the rules. Only things happen. So the Buddha said, okay, you don't do that.
So this 311 rules was set by the Buddha those days when there was a bhikkhuni
yes.
So the Buddha set 311 rules more than what he set for the monks, is it?
Actually, because the Bhikkhu Sangha established before the Bhikkhuni Sangha.
Yes.
So actually, when we have the Bhikkhuni Sangha, actually we already inherited some of those rules. That's why you can see some of the Bhikkhu's rules and the Bhikkhuni rules that they have the common rules. And on top of that, like things happen. For example, some like the Buddha said, like one of the rules that the Bhikkhuni to not be allowed to be public. You know, so because the Bhikkhunis was they were being invited like to take as much as they can the diet, and then so really they finish up the whole farm, you know, then the diet. And because I can understand why actually some initially when I look at all these Bhikkhuni rules, it seems like it doesn't make sense, but as you live the life you can understand why the Buddhas did that. Because you have to put the blanket, you know, blanket, okay, that's it, you don't do that. Because if you try to say, maybe under this situation you can understand, I think we have 600, 700. It's true, you know, and because this happened to us, like for example, in our monastery, we have beside the Bhikkhuni's rules, we have our house rules, like a monastic rule is that called what? Like some of the things that they're not allowed to do because of to help the community to live in harmony. Like so, for example, someone comes up to complain, someone making noise at this time, you know. So it's okay during this time, quiet time, no one allowed to make noise. This is one rule. and I can understand sometimes like you know when you make allowances and sometimes like things turns. It becomes like an issue. For example, we have a rule that like we wash the bowl, and so we have to dry the bowl in the other area. So then, but they have to come up into the place and put back the bowl like one all the way around. It's a bit further, but there is a shortcut that is they go through the office, you know. And I was a bit, you know, out of kindness and compassion. He said, oh, they're walking a bit far. So I made allowance. I said, okay. Actually, initially, the rules is that we can't go through the office. Like, the office is not a public area. We are not allowed to use the office as an entrance, even though you can enter through outside. But I was thinking that they have to go all the way, you know, quite far to the other side. So I was thinking, okay, I made an exceptional case. When only we put the bowl in, you can use this door. But of course, it's ended up that the door becomes a public entrance. And sometimes they let the door open. And the office, you know, sometimes I have my things, documents, things in the office. And sometimes I walk away, and sometimes my cabinet, we do have donations, things like that in the cupboard, you know, things like that. I've been not locked. And of course, sometimes like, we have people come, we don't know who will come in, then I have to be responsible for any loss, you know. And how am I going to explain to the committee, the society, you know? Then I said, okay, because that everybody just use it, it's ended up becomes an issue. Everybody left the door open, no one responsible, and left the door open, become a public area. So the next day I said, okay, from today onwards, no one allowed to use the entrance. Then I can really understand why the Buddha said, okay, no, that's it. Because sometimes you try to make allowances, it causes so much problem. So I started, actually only when you live the life, you know how the rules apply and why is this rule apply. And because sometimes when you look at it, it doesn't make sense, you know. You know, like it doesn't make sense at all. But only when you live the life, and then you know the practicality, why, and a lot of those rules actually is to really protect the bhikkhuni. For example, like the bhikkhuni is not allowed to do house a chores or a householder. Actually, it's to protect the bhikkhuni, to not to become the slave to the householder, and not to serve the monks. You know, because during the Buddha's time. women that have very low status, that low self-esteem, you know, and they always, you know, become like, you know, serving moms and serving householder. So this rule is to protect the people need. It's actually to protect them. It's not to make life difficult. So if you understand the rules, actually you love to keep it. You enjoy keeping it because it's really, you know, it's wonderful. And just recently, you know, of course, like for example, like in the monastery, I've got sometimes like our seminary, our anagarikas, and sometimes like sometimes it's just a small things. Like sometimes I have some bad habits of doing things. For example, actually something small, but they need to pray. If they can't, like Achan Cha said, why is the monk distro? Because the monk distro is not because that they commit parachika or something like those illegal offense or all those grave offense. But small rules, we tend to overlook those habitual pattern. So the reason why we have these rules that or this house rule kawa is to recondition our whole old habit. You know, this old habit die hard, you know, because that when we develop certain habitual pattern, actually it's very difficult to change. So when we come to monastic life, actually it takes away your normal, you know, the worldly conditions that they have been doing. So a lot of things they are not allowed, we do things differently. Because that is to make a break of that. Because we do it without knowing, like automatic pilot, we're just doing it unconsciously. So we have this rule, it's not to make life difficult, it's like a break to change our conditioning. So sometimes people tend to fix up all this bad habit. Like, for example, like we live this monastic life, all these rules actually is to help us to cultivate mindfulness. Whatever we do, for example, when we wash our bowl, so we have certain rules called what, that when you wash a bowl, you have to wash it quietly, you know. So we normally like this, we have to squat down to wash the bowl because during Buddha's time, the bowl usually is made of clay, is breakable and broke easily. So that's like we have to squat down and also we have the respect because the bowl is we are alms mendicant, we are the daughter of the Buddha. So this is our inheritance. So we respect the fact that we are none. So we quietly, we dry our bowl, and then one by one, we put it up and, you know, and sun it and we bring it back. Of course, sometimes we are visiting nuns to come, and they started to wash the bowl like washing dishes. They're stacking all the bowl, like washing the dishes. And initially when I saw it, I just, okay, I keep quiet, I just see how long they do. But they keep doing it. Doesn't matter. And because there's like, for example, we have we call it Upantak, like our attendant. And she makes up my lid, she makes up my stand, she makes up my, what's that called it, even spoon, you know, different things, you know, because you're supposed to wash one by one, put it up and bring it back. This is to cultivate mindfulness. So, and it's not once, it's all the time. Then I started to, okay, it's enough. You know? Then I have to tell them, you know, I said, you know, ask yourself, why are you living this life? If you want to continue this old habitual pattern, you better go back and practice, you go back, you know. It's just completely wasting of time. You know, you do it quickly, you wash your bowl, you give it all you got. I said, I can see how mindful you are. And then people will come and complain that, oh, I haven't got my nimitta. No, I've been here 2 years, you know, I haven't got my nimitta. But they didn't even have a basic mindfulness awareness. Washing the bowl, they mix up all the leaves, you know. I said, this is the things that you really have to place important everyday life. This is mindfulness. I said, this is why we live in the monastery, to cultivate the mindfulness. And then I said, you know, I said, you don't have to tell education, you don't have to come and help you. So that's why I said, you see, call them. I said, I'm not here to judge them. I said, I'm not here to make you feel guilty. I said, I'm not to take it personally. And please, because for us, like every 2 weeks that we have the impositor day, so normally we have a monastic chant. We chant the 10 dhammas, the reflections. So once for one who has gone far. So I asked them, how often do you chant? So we usually said we chant in a group is once every 2 weeks. I said, it's not enough. You should chant it every day to remind yourself why you need this life. And I told them, being a nun is very rare. We tend to take it for granted. To be appreciative, to have the gratitude, the fact that we make lots of good karma in order to come to this point, to become a nun. Sometimes we tend to take it for granted. So we recite every day. The 10th, do you know what is the 10 subjects of the collection? The first one, I am no longer living according to worldly aims and values. He should be reflected again and again for one who has gone for. The second one, my very life is sustained through the gifts of others. We remind ourselves. So we rely on the generosity of the lay people. So it's important. Do we, you know, worthy of respect, worthy of offerings? Because we tend to, especially when we live in the monastery, after a while you get used to it, and then, you know, fall back into the old habit pattern. So what's the point? So we live like a hermit. It's not like a bunch of good women. I know they're good, you know, it's not that they're bad. They're all good women. They have the sincerity, they have the willingness. But, you know, but we need to guide them. I said, we're here to support you, to guide you, to help you. To help you to take in, to stay in ropes. You know, it's not to try to make someone guilty or putting someone down. You know, whoever, for example, like the all these rules, you know, actually the purpose of having these rules, like compassion, is not to putting someone down or make someone guilty. Actually, to pull someone up, to try to help someone to keep that person in ropes. It's not to try to make that. That is why to make the person to see and remind themselves and not to repeat them again. And the third one, that I should strive to abandon my former habits. You should do that again and again by one who has gone before. And the fourth one, you know, this regret arises in my mind, you know. These should be reflected again and again for one who has gone far. And the fifth one, that, you know, this is my spiritual companion, find fault with my conduct. And the sixth one, all that is mine, beloved and pleasing, will become otherwise, will become separated from me. Because some of those, you know, young nun, the friend come, the relative come, they quickly finish their job and go and talk to the family. I said, you know, you still hold on to your family. So why? You have to reflect. You are no longer a householder. You are a nun. So you have to step, do this, let go, detach of your family. You know, quickly finish the job and talk to the friends. I said, you don't have to entertain your friends, you know. I said, for example, I said, I put myself out. I need to, after Dharma, talk to the lay people. I said, they can go back to meditate. You don't have to be a social butterfly to talk to the lay people. You know? And I said, if like that, and myself, the other way around, you come in and talk to the lay people, I go back and meditate. And this is how, because we tend to get pulled, you know. The pull is very strong, like the friends and, you know. And because it's this habitual pattern is very strong. Like, from. It's, of course, you know, it's not easy to change. Of course, the first few years, you don't have a sense of monastic. And I never judge them. But they have to be reminded. You have to remind them. Because you can't support that. So that is my responsibility. Because the seminary, the Anagarikas, they do take dependence on me. Like, to ask me to be the guide. So that's my duty to remind them. You know, that, you know, what are you doing? You know, you have to remind yourself. You don't do that. So, yeah, the seventh one, we are the owner of our karma, made to my karma, born of our karma, abide supported by our karma. What karma shall that we do for good or for ill, of that we shall be the end. So, we are the owner of our karma. So, make good karma. And the days and nights are relentlessly passing. How well am I spending my time? You're wasting time. You know. So, do I delight in solitudes or not? And the last one, you know, as my practice for fruits with freedom of insight, so that at the end of my life, I do not feel ashamed when questions by my spiritual companion. So, this is like, you know, and it's very important, whatever we do, we have to start with the right understanding, the right view. Right view is not that I'm right, then you're wrong. So right in the context, that leads us to freedom, to lead us to become a compassionate person, to be able to live harmoniously, you know, within ourselves. Sometimes we are not happy with ourselves, you know. We are fighting with ourselves, some conflicts within ourselves, within our family members, within the society, within a larger community. That is, you know, and that, because sometimes there is, why there is conflicts, disputes, because we're holding to the wheels. It's not that we shouldn't have wheels, but holding on to wheels is wrong wheel. Because it causes suffering. So the Buddha said wholesome and unwholesome. It's not right or wrong. It's alright, you know. If you want to suffer, so you continue to do it. You know? So if you don't want to suffer, so the Buddha still with the cut like, this is what you do. You know, if you want to suffer, okay, go ahead, continue to do that. So this is how, you know, it's important. That's like, the whole of this part, the Noble Four part, start with right understanding. So it's like we need to have a little bit of wisdom to start up with, you know. So we have this small wisdom in order to accomplish the big wisdom. So the air is also the wisdom, so this right view. And this view, you know, why we've been, you know, wandering in the samsara countless lifetime? Because of our ignorant, but ignorant itself has its condition. That is distorted view. And where is this distorted view come from? From our distorted perception. The perception. So when there is a contact, feeling arises, whether we like it or we don't like it. So then we perceive things according to our likes and delights. It's like we bend towards, you know, what we like, you know. So we perceive things in a certain way. And this is how, and then we started to this perception. And we perceive these things in a certain way. Then we start to think about it. You know, then it develops a view. A certain views of, how we view the world, you know. This is how it develops the views. And it's actually, it's remind me in the West, you know, like, you see, how we have different conditioning. You see, sometimes it's like for me, it's very interesting in the monastery, because in the monastery, each one comes in with their own baggage, you know, different conditioning. So of course, each one of them, you know, we all have our own idiosyncrasy, you know. Sometimes we think that others is not that normal, but others think that we are not normal too, you know. And because we are being conditioned, but you know, the mind is a conditioned thing. And of course, in the West, they think that 13 is not a lucky number. Unlucky number. I remember one day a lady came. She was so worried because she had a housewarming. She chose the date is 13 of Friday. So everybody kept telling her that you shouldn't choose this day. It's really unlucky, you know. You shouldn't, you know, 13, you know, Friday on top of that Friday. And she was so worried. Then I told her, I'm not worried. I said, you know, 13 for Chinese is good. You know, some people even, you know, I said in Malaysia, you know, some of the time, people, you know, tend to, you know, to how much, spend so much money to get the number 13. And they said it's unlucky. And this is how we try to make sense. We try to put two and two together, for example, because we form that view. If we believe that 13 is unlucky, it's something unfortunate happened, someone died. And we think that because of we have this unlucky number, it's not. We have this body, we are all going to die. Whether we have this number or not. You know? But we try to make two and two together and make sense of that. Then we develop this view. And those believe that 13 is lucky. And oh, they won a lottery. Oh my goodness, because I got this number. It's not. It's just that maybe in the past that they have done some, you know, good deed. And it's happened. Whether he got the number or not, he still some got the material well-being, you know. It's nothing to do with the number. But we try to put it together. We think about it, you know, when the perceptions come and the thoughts, you know, and then followed by the view. And again, we reinforce our view. And this is a true story. One of my our supporter, she used to come every week to offer dana, and she told us that quite a few years ago, and she used to pass by a corner. There was there were some bikies, you know, that those bikies, they had a bike and someone died. So each time she passed by the area, and she felt a lot of energy and the beings there, one bike died. So this she believed. And she feel that there's a kind of very strong energy feelings that there's a being with the loving kindness. So each time she passed by, she sent loving kindness. So she feels so strong, and then she's giving loving kindness for quite a few years, you know, when she passed. And she really feel that being there. After a few years, she discovered that the person still alive. Actually, we reinforce that because you know why? When we develop the views, then when next time the same situations, the feeling becomes stronger. And then we reinforce our perception. The perception becomes stronger. And then we think about it. Actually, we manifest, we create the feelings, we create that. You know, you see some people think that they're unwell, you know. The more they think about it, they think they almost die. You know? And this is really, you know, and this is how perception is so, but we all believe and how if we understand the limitation of perception, so we were not bound by that. And why we have all these conflicts and war and people can't get along because they hold on to our beliefs, my belief, what I believe is true. Because it's so true. You know, and I just not long ago, just last month, I was invited to be one of the panel speakers in a school. They have this multicultural events. But I find it's very good because of they have this different come from different faith, like for example, Muslim, Jewish, you know. And all of them, they have four speakers, they're all men. So because they don't have female speaker, so the organizer would love to have a female speaker. So and I was reminded, you see, it's good to be a female speaker. And they have this like they introduce the students. They are all year 7. That is from 11 to 13. To introduce them other religions, other cultures, so they bring the aim is to bring people together. They have the understanding, the respect of others' beliefs, you know, religions and culture. So I was giving 5 minutes presentation about Buddhism, 5 minutes. So after 5 minutes, so we have a panel, speakers, so we take questions. So the students will ask questions. So I find that it's quite challenging because sometimes they can be very thoughtful and challenging questions, especially at this age. But I find that it's really important, like, you know, to have this, you know, to have this, to bring people together, you know. To not to develop his views. I'm right, you know, my religion is the best religion, you know. And to have this tolerance, you know, to cultivate this, you know, kindness and compassion. So because I was giving only 5 minutes, what can I say? So I just straight walk down, straight to the point. So because this part of practice, you know, I started to think, you know, what I'm going to say by this reason. Actually, this whole part of practice is a part of purification. So as your mind becomes purer and purer, you are naturally kind. So you don't have to sit there and argue, I'm happy, I'm happy, I'm happy, I'm happy. You know, if you are a virtuous person, you are naturally kind. So then I was thinking, okay, then actually the Buddhism is kindness, compassion. So I just introduced myself, okay, it's my name, and my Buddhist nun, and my religion is kindness. I practice kindness. Yeah, I just tell them what is kindness, what is meant by loving kindness. Loving kindness means goodwill, wishing ourselves to have goodwill towards ourselves. You know, it's not that, you know, it's like a technique, you know, to try to suppress that, you know. Lots of people think that it's not working. Because a lot of people practice loving kindness, they use it as a technique to suppress that emotion. You know, they're happy, well, I'm happy, happy, you know. Just focus, and then the more that they say that, you know, they really hold their hand, you know, how you want to be happy. And then you become like suppressing your emotions. You are not really looking at what actually a true loving kindness said. You look at your emotion, even the horrible feelings that you feel right now. You have compassion to accept who we are. Like in a way, it's like, you know, like someone has depression. There's nothing wrong with depression, but because people think that we shouldn't have depression.
Huh?
We shouldn't, because this is just emotions come and go, impermanent, non-self. That's why the Buddha said that we have these four distortion of perceptions, distortion of heart and view, distortion of impermanent as permanent, non-self as self, foulness, something is foul as beauty. You know, that is a suffering as happiness. Yeah, this distorted view. So this is come from the sense of self, the ego. So we think that we shouldn't. We are not accepting who we are. I remember in the early days. You know, I find that, like, for example, I used to think that I'm, you know, I was thinking I was such a kind and loving person. And then I realized that actually I'm not that kind. kind and not that loving girls are to renounce that, exclude you, you know. I find that it's very difficult to accept the fact that I'm not perfect. Because it's fine, because, you know, theoretically you understand, it's fine that other people is not perfect, but not me. I'm supposed to be, you know, I'm supposed to be better, you know. I find it so difficult, you know, especially when I make mistakes. I can't get over, you know, like I keep beating myself up like I shouldn't make mistakes because I should be perfect. But, and I find that I can forgive others easily because others, it's not me. Actually, this is come from the sense of self, like, you know, it's the attachment. This is the Buddha said this is the wrong view. And each time when we suffer, we investigate where is the suffering coming from. I can guarantee you nothing outside the sense of self. I remember once too, you know, I was very upset with my sibling, my family's member. So my mind got on and on and on, can't stop thinking that, you know, the self-righteousness is wrong, you know. And I started to, and then, oh, in a certain, I stopped and asking myself, why? You know, if I really love that person, the true loving kindness, unconditional love. It's not that, ooh, you know, you have to live up to my expectation, then I love you. You don't live up to my expectation, I do not love you. Then I just ask myself, I do not love that person because I think that, you know, the self-righteousness is wrong. You know, that, because actually make us feel good. You know, the sense of self makes us feel good. And then we create the sense of self, you know. I remember, you know, because as a nun, sometimes you have people come, you know, especially, relationship problems. I remember this, a young couple. This man is young, he's 20. So of course, you know, after 7 years together, and 7 years each. And, you know, he started to say, you know, like, you know, thing to talk to my, you know, wife, you know, like we started to have, like, of course, and he met someone, you know, that they have more same interests, you know, they can, you know, that, like he said that, you know, I can't relate to my wife, I can't communicate with her, like, you always, like, different views and opinions, then we argue, and the other girl, you know, like, we can get on so well, you know. And that, you know, we have the same views and same interests. And I looked at him and I said, actually, two of you are reinforcing your own demands. You are reinforcing your own sense of self. Because, of course, someone didn't agree with you, they reaffirm your sense of self, your views. Of course, you like it. You know, if someone agree with you, you like the person much more, isn't it? And because your wife disagrees with you, because it's conflict in the self-interest, the sense of self. Actually, that moment he just said, yeah, actually it's true, he said, you know. Because he said when he served his customer, he said, actually, he noticed that you know, the customers, he said, my clients, they don't care whether how good your product is, how good you are, how skillful you are. He always said yes, yes, you know, and then you always agree with that news. He said the chances of the sales is very high. immediately he just woke up to that. And I point out, I said, you know, actually, you know, that is you really forcing the sense of self. You know, because the person agree with your views, then you say, ah, you see, we're happy. For example, the someone that you don't like. And then when they do something that's wrong, you say, yes, you see, I told you already, that person always, you know, always done that, you know, you did that again. Because it's reaffirm your view about that person. She is like that. Because we give us a sense of, we feel satisfied, we love it. Sense of self, the ego, you know. You feel our ego, sense of self. This is important, so we really have to question each time our perception. No, whether this is your cause so a lot of issues, dispute, you know, disharmony within the family, and also the sense of self because the ego. So this is how we extend our sense of self from ourselves. This is how, like, if any relationship you have to base on friendship, that is kindness, loving kindness, and then this relationship be able to enhance and also stay long. If relationships, for example, partners or husband and wife, it is based on lust. So not last. Because according to the research, the neuron in the brain, you know, when someone in love, you know, the emotion side, you know, that override the logical side, then the person will be the most wonderful person in the world. You know, you look at the partner, even they're picking their eye jump around, even they're picking their noses, so they look beautiful. You know, this is how, you know, they say it's won't last. But if relationship based on trust, trust is also a loving kindness, you know, kindness, friendliness. And this kind of relationship lasts. It's very important because when we try to make that person, me and mine, then we started not to trust that person. And this happened is one of the lady she caught up because of her husband left her. After her husband left her, she started to look at why. And actually she realized that actually is that because of she's being very controlling. Because the first time she met her husband, oh, she's, you know, love at first sight. And then she might marry, you know, her husband. Because of the attachment towards her husband. So that's why a lot of people think that the more you attach to someone, that means you love that person so much. Actually, it's not. Attachment is not really true love. So then, because you attach to someone, you have to give, to lose that person. Then she becomes very controlling. So she starts to question her husband a little bit late, where have you been, and check him, you know, see whether, you know, get the ship to send me perfume, you know. And checking up. Of course, after a while, the husband is really gets sick of her because she's so controlling. Eventually, the husband left her. Then she realized that because of her controlling, her sense of self, that she's trying to control. They said, when the stronger sense of self we have, we try to control everyone. We control our partners, we control our children, we control our friends. We become a control freak. We control everybody. It's true, you know. They say it's very important, like kindness, you know, relationship, you know, kindness. They say this view, you know, this. They say if we have this right understanding, reflection is about our perception. Then we started to look at it. Then we change our perception. Sometimes it's important to change our perception so we can think to develop the perceptions. Of course, it's still a perception. We develop the perceptions of impermanent, non-self, like to see things that instead of happiness, then it's suffering. Of course, it's still a perception, but we need to, you know, to for example, we can't just let that go, you know. Then, just for example, we have to make use of the wrath, you know. So we have to cultivate the wholesome. So we still have to hold to the wholesome. Then, when we with the wholesome, because only with the wholesome mind, with the happiness, because developing develop this wisdom, we have to have this peaceful mind. The peaceful mind, we need to have the happiness. So the happiness comes from keeping the precepts to be a virtuous person, to be a generous person. Generous is not only giving like three things, you know, being kind is also generous. Even kind to ourselves is generous. So actually, that the goodness itself, you know, give you lots of happiness. When you have the happiness, you have to generate lots of energy. Then your mind becomes peaceful easily. Then the peace of mind, then that is developed the wisdom. So the Buddha said, the only way to break through the perversions of perception is to abandon the five hindrances, because the five hindrances crowded the mind. So the crowded, so we need to, keeping the precepts is to weaken the five hindrances. So as we weaken the five hindrances, then with the developing of the stillness, then that is where our wisdom arises, then we can see things as they really are. And this is important that we, you know, questions, you know, our perceptions. So not to, sometimes, you know, we do not believe that, you know, what we see. Yeah. And sometimes we really manufacture the feelings and manifest, you know, and create lots of suffering for ourselves and for others. So any questions or comments or anything that we need to ask?
The 311 rules, are they to train the person to become more discerning?
Yeah, because you become more mindful. Like for example, like for example, they are not allowed to be alone with a man. So we have to be really consciously aware. You know, that to avoid that situation. Of course, sometimes that we can't avoid, that we have to confess, but we don't take it lightly. You say, oh, it doesn't matter, all I need to do is just confess. Then missing the point. So we keep it in the best of our ability. But of course, sometimes it's beyond our control. For example, one time when I was with us, when Bursari, from we went to Sankey to attend a seminar. So one of the Anangarika sent two of us to the airport. So she's going to Melbourne to meet her family. I go back to to the monastery. So we were running late. So we almost missed the flight, because the flight is 9:10. I arrived at the airport at 9:00. So then what to do? So I have to tell the authorities that please come and check us in case, because we have no money. So in case that we miss a flight, please, you know, have to take me back to Sankey. You know, of course, I consciously aware of that, but I was being put in the situation that I can't help it. Like, you know, then next time we become more careful. Try to avoid the situation, not to say, oh, it doesn't matter, it's just a small rule. Or then you do it again, and then you confess, you do it again. So what is this rule for? You know, and that's why we try, you know, that actually you become more aware, like the situations. I remember just, I told Barbara today, you know, especially in the West. So we had to ask a tree surgeon to look at the tree, because it's a big stump. It fallen off, and it's quite close to our workshop, our garage, because it's quite dangerous. The damage on the garage is really huge. So I asked him to come and give us a quote. So, but it's too big for a job for him, because it's just a small business, it's a one-man show, you know. So then he said that, you know, he can't do it, and he gave me some suggestion. So, but he come all the way here to give a free quote. So then, because out of kindness, you know, like, you know, come all the way here, you know, so at least I said, may I offer you a cup of tea, you know, because you come all the way here. Oh, it's all right. Sila, So actually, it's a gradual training. It's a whole part of purification.
I remember last year I was at the Jhana Grove for the Easter retreat, and Sister Bayama was giving the talk, and Sister Suri told us after reciting her first 311 rules, she cried because she felt the pureness in not even breaking 1%. And after hearing that, we all cried. Because of the joy hearing that she can actually complete the 311 precept and the joy that arises.
Yes, we do, like, for example, like, if we have to, like, we have to, like, have a confession before we recite the Patimokkha. So then, yeah, we have to declare, are you pure? Are you pure 3 times, you know? Then we declare we are pure, like, you know? So we always start to kneel. Like we clear the you know, the, whatever we have, you know. Most of the people, especially the people that come to our monastery to pray, they all have the sincerity and willingness. Because most of the seminary and Americas, it's not that they are failure. Many of them are really successful. They have successful career. Like we have scientists. We have lots of applications, like medical doctors. You know, yeah, we do. Like, you know, and some that they did very well in their career too. You know, it's not that they're failure, that they become a nun. It's just because they really want to pursue this path.
No,
we are not going to have religious.
Not going to have. We will have been having all the
years.
So there's no hot shower.
In the evolution block we have, like winter time, we do need to have a shower.
Is on the field, all the youths can use, you know, and the cookies of those are not.
Because of we have to comply with the immigration rules and regulations that the training decisions I have to offer to Australia national first, and then if no one fill up the if there is a lack of candidates to fill up the positions, then only we can attempt to suitable candidate to fill up. We have to apply this application. There's a big, you know, it's quite a lot of paperwork and things like that. But it's not that it's impossible, but usually I encourage those that are interested to live the monastic life. They come to stay in the monastery as a lay person first. Mm-hmm. To know, you know, sometimes people, you know, want to become a nun, have a lot of preconceived idea how a nun is, you know? and actually sometimes reality is pretty boring. so it's just, you know, it's like some people have a lot of romantics, you know, ideas about nun. So it's important, it's good that you have the passion, you have the love, you have the joy, and you enjoy this monastic life, then you can stay in Rome. If you have too much of an idea being a nun, then this is because when you become a nun, because the lifestyle, the practice is different when you are outside. Because we can easily distract ourselves by just shopping, calling your friends, you don't have to face your own defilements, you don't have to face yourself. But being a nun, you will put in a cage. You know, you really kick out all the defilements come out, you know. Then you really have to work with it. And plurality, you know, is that. But if you can, if people can stay long enough, actually ultimately it's really good because if you overcome that defilements, you work with that defilements that, you know, is important. But a lot of people, you know, people that have a lot of these ideas of being a nun, then they come to monastic life, they have competition, they put on a show, be a perfect nun, a Miss Nun, a Mr. Nun, you know? then it's missing the point, you know, actually. And you become very stressed. How long you can last? If you put on the show, a strip jacket, you know, and you can't. You become very tense, and you can't live in monastic life long because you don't have the, you will not enjoy your monastic life. So if you relax, you know, you have the joy, you have the happiness, then you can stay in robes. Say, ask me a question. Multicultural events, you know, we do. So that person obviously have really don't know us, like, that what we have done, and we work very hard. Actually, so, you know, we do the things all by ourselves. We live in the forest, though. I have to take a chainsaw class. It's true, because you know, because we live in the bush and bushfire season, so we have to have this fire action plan, evacuation plan to get ready. So we do have like a drill, like, you know, we do make sure that happen. You know, we do have training. You know, then I remember when we trained that we had our own fire fighting pump. You know, we do all this. You know, we do it all by ourselves. You know, but I find that it's very important. It's good that because give lots of women self confidence. Because for example, we all climb up to the roof and clean doctors. We do many job. You know, and I remember, you know, some lay people, some women to them like, oh, this is man job. Oh, why do you do that? Do you have harness? And no, it's dangerous. Oh, you should ask a man to do it. I said, a man? Where am I going to get a man?
It's just like the mom, they have to learn how to sew too.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, we sew and yeah, we do it, you know. So actually, it's good that because people lots of women to have the self-confidence to think that, you know, because a lot of women they lack the self-confidence and think that, you know, I can't. If you think that you can't, you know. And actually it's important that having the mask. It's not that I'm trying to advertise that. Actually it's really, you know, it's not how it, because I know how difficult it is for myself to become a nun. So of course because of that I would really love to give the opportunities to other women. So that's why I try my best, like, to support, you know, to give support to the women to live this life or to have a taste of this life. You know, not all women want to become a nun, but at least we provide the opportunities. If they want to become a nun, at least the opportunities. It's just like in the olden days, women is not allowed to go to school. And this doesn't mean that women are less intelligent or less pretty, because they're not, they weren't given the opportunities. The same thing, you know, be given the opportunities. So how to, you know, if they choose to become a nun, that is the opportunities.
Venerable, can you share with us your trip to India to bring back the suffering monks?
Yeah, when we were there, actually it's really inspiring. Because you're so touched by this Maha Thera, that he gave us the recognitions and the state, that Bhikkhuni. Actually, we arrived there. Actually, usually this Maha Thera, he normally don't come up, occasion like that.
This is Maha Thera.
Actually, Anuradhapura. He's got a long title. I just can't, a mouthful, I can't even pronounce his name.
It's
very hard. Because the original one, Arahan Sankamita Thera, she took this southern branch of that body tree from Wakaya to Sri Lanka.
And Asuka's daughter.
Yes. Then from Sri Lanka, now the actually the tree is still there. So then that one is a seed, it is a seed as a sapling that we brought back to Australia. So it's just like, you know, from the it's a historical event that from India to Sri Lanka, because Arahan Sankamita Thera, she's the one who established the Bhikkhuni ordination. The order there, and then now from that to bring to Dhammasara, because one of the reasons the Maha Thera offered this to us, because he said that we are the only Bhikkhuni monastery in this tradition, it's a training monastery in this tradition. So that is really very auspicious and it's a historical event that from Sri Lanka come to Australia. So they said, oh, this is an Australian version of Sankarita. I noticed that the different wine, like in general, I noticed that the Sri Lankan men are more respectful to women, and because they have bhikkhuni.
True.
And Sri Lanka is the first country that had a prime minister, woman prime minister. So in general, when we were there, even all the men, you know, they are very respectful to the bhikkhuni. Because they have the idea that because when we talk about that, we have some Thai supporter. She said that because of they don't have the cost, they never in because in Thailand, like Burma, because they don't have bhikkhuni. So they said that they don't really know how to, you know, no bhikkhuni there, so it's different. So but whereas in Sri Lanka they have bhikkhuni, so that then they know, you know, how to respect the bhikkhuni and actually and also is in general in Sri Lanka most of the women are very highly educated. When we were there, most of the women come to see us, they're all professor, medical doctor, even in a person. She was there, she got a big bag. She got a medical doctor to come and look at her. Yeah, we were so touched, right? And they were so inspired that you had the bhikkhuni.
Malaysians are very shy in asking questions.
Yeah, it's true.
Maybe because it's our culture not to ask questions. Sometimes the family has to go back to stay with their own householders.
preceptors or 10 preceptors or visiting devotees can just come and stay there and call it a place of their own. Otherwise now, if only has to stay in GF, the one room there, and at night I have to accompany them and stay with them, VGF, the Sangha room. So if they have their own center, we householders don't even have to go in and stay with them. Now because they cannot be alone and left in VGF, they have to come in.
But
so that's our
belief.
Right?
It's also shot
block
by upstairs now.
Yes.
That's
a temporary premise. In future, if we can raise enough funds, we can get maybe a double story corner house where there's a garden where we can walk. While this shop lot, they are just stuck upstairs, you know, no place to walk and all that. So we have raised enough funds. So we hope to hold a little workshop in June. Just to, because now we don't know who are the 8 receptors in Malaysia, where are they, who are the 10 receptors. Because now we have come to Aya, and Sister Shamangla, she's a seminary, and also there's what Aya Kalyani, who is, I think, in Sri Lanka now. So there are two fully ordained Bhikkhunis, there are a few 10 receptors, but and a few who are in Myanmar, the learning, practicing, some are in Tushita Hermitage in teaching. But whether they want to come back and want to stay there and start a little hermitage in Malaysia, we call it the Bokami Vihara. And then maybe later on we can invite Aya back to teach them for maybe a month or 2 or 3 months if she's available. And Aya Santini also agreed to come in and teach for a month. So they can share and build up the community. And later on maybe we can get enough scholarships to send them to Australia for training, or Sri Lanka for training.
We have more applicants now.
We have questions.
It's important. No question. I just find that it's a noble thing that you're doing.
Uh-huh.
And it's very similar to what I've heard about a lady, her name Anil Chongbin. She's a Nepalese, and in the country of Nepal, the females are not given a lot of status, and many of the ladies wants to be a nun. There's no nunnery to teach them, and she started from scratch. She got a beautiful voice, not much of a musician or instruments, but she could sing, and she used that as one channel to raise money throughout the world, and now build a nunnery there. So it's also a very beautiful nunnery. Where they have children, very young children, to very elderly people who are nuns.
I would like to say and share with you one of them. I told you about the multicultural event. That actually after that event, that that's on the 27th of November, that's we had a food fair to raise money for the nuns' monastery. And when I was there, a lady came up. Said, who is the nun that told the, giving the talks at the multicultural events? I said, oh, I am. She said, oh, because her daughter asked her that if you go to Dhammaloka, if you see that nun, please express my gratitude and appreciation to the nun. Because of the, she told me that her daughter really loves it. And I think this is important, like, especially for a young girl, to have that, to see someone like, it's not really so much that what I said is really important, but because if someone stand up there, have the confidence to say, actually gives a lot of encouragement to the young girl, then he's inspired, then I think that it's possible. And then I got the feedback that after that event, so they have the newsletter, so they wrote the essay, so who they really, they liked, that. So they said, I got the most. So, yeah, I mean, they're all quite interested, they love it, and then the parents said to me that, it's good to have it more. That is actually it's important for young girl to have someone to have like a female to role model to inspire them. Because I know it's, when I was in Thailand, I know how is it like. Even because of their being home, that they are second class, they are not good. Mm-hmm. And they believe that. You know, they believe that, yes, I'm not good, I'm not as good. You know, they believe that, you know. Be tall, be conditioned. So they say it's important why we have a female monastic like leaders. Because I know even some places, they say being a nun, the nuns that you do social work is not being a teacher or being a leader. So they say it's important that we have female leaders and monastic teacher that actually is encouraging, you know, is people lots of self-confidence or lots of young girls. Because I know I feel sorry for lots of the teenagers, because when I heard that, I feel really happy too. At least I can give something, you know. At least that they like it, that loves it, you know. Especially that girl, the teenager says she's 11, her mom said like she like it. I think maybe she see because I'm the only female there, right? Just to stand up and talk and the rest is all men. So today it's really encouraging. So I say it's really important to
I think the answer I'm very confused about this. You mentioned that the people are confused about nuns, bhikkhunis, saris. Now I'm going to ask this question. Sare and bhikkhunis, are they the same?
No, because actually for in Burma, the sare is just like we call Meiji.
It's a
mean nun.
Okay.
I know they have brown, but it's different. I was not used to have a patch robe.
Because they...
I know.
Because Sari Dimankara, she's a...
They are not the patch robe man, and then they do wear like that. This is a forest tradition. Oh. We have cover one like that. The album is just black like that. I know, because when we were 10 precept now, we wear brown like that.
So you distinguish by the way they wear the robe, is it?
No, bodies. They say people confused. They say
they're not nuns. They are nuns.
They are. I mean, there is not most of them like they don't really have that the bhikkhuni ordination because Burma they don't have bhikkhuni ordinations. Most of them, like for example, some of them are just eight precepts, and some of them just keep extra precepts. They don't even have seminary ordination.
So they are also nuns. But they are not the same as bhikkhuni.
No, I mean, they're just like lean, a precepts. For us, lean is a training nun. To us, like they're not, that is not initiated by the by Buddha. You know, they say people are so confused.
It's basically through the ordination.
Yeah, through the ordination.
It's an ordination by the monk.
No. The bhikkhuni ordination had to be ordained by bhikkhuni.
Yes.
You have to have at least 5 bhikkhuni, that is a sangha karma, we call it a sangha karma. One motion and 3 announcements. And then when the bhikkhuni sanghas ordain the bhikkhuni, that is a ordain on one side. Then the bhikkhuni have to go to the bhikkhu sangha to get the confirmation from the bhikkhu sangha. The bhikkhu sangha also at least have to have 5. So we have to have the sangha karma, we call it the sangha karma, then that is the validity.
So many people are mistaken when actually took place.
Sorry. Yeah.
I am very confused.
It's through the ordination.
Now, Sumangala is ordained by Bhante Mahinda because I was there when he ordained her. So, and she wore this of the brown, the black brown on the robe. So what? She's a nun also.
Like Venerable say, according to the Buddha's time, the presence of how many bhikkhuni, how many sangha. So that is the proper order. Mm-hmm. So whatever it is, we are not sure, but the proper order is such a... Yes.
It, because actually salmonary ordination is actually during that time salmonary is for those that are underage, you know, like the same like salmonera, you know. And actually during Buddha's time, like some of those are like young, you know, that's why you have to be at least 20 years old. So actually the salmonera ordination is not a sankakama. It's not a, you know. So in a bhikkhuni ordination, you have to have that. That is, we call it a full ordination.
The ordination proper.
Yeah.
So I'm very confused because some say, I saw my own eyes was ordained, my mother said someone cannot ordain, you know? So it's just like, this is the correct Buddha's ordination. This is a proper way of, during Buddha's time was like that. This is the only tradition.
That's why I was thinking, oh, it's really confusing. So you're either a nun or not a nun.
Is it
a
nun or so? I hope so.
Venerable lady, may I call you that?
Yes.
Please be called Venerable Sir. Venerable lady.
Yeah. Actually, Aya also is meant for Venerable Lady or Venerable Sister.
Yes, I'm a bit concerned. Is Ajahn Wayama and Venerable Sari doing fine?
Ajahn Wayama, because she had this, they call it a cerebral degenerating syndrome. So it's incurable. So it's just a matter of time that how fast she's going to deteriorate. That is part of her illness. Yes, because I have been, sometimes I haven't seen her because also we busy in the monastery. So yeah, but we'll come to a point that she had to be like bedridden, like she can't walk, like she can't swallow. It's incurable, like if you become like can't swallow, then you have to teach her to feed. So then why do they have this complication when the food injected into the lung and then they have complication infection. So this is her illness. So she's been well taken care of. She had lots of three times a week she had usual and alternative treatments to try to help her to slow down her deterioration. So that this is the only way that we can do. So, but time happy business to do sometimes we can't, just like the Buddha said, you see, this is our karma. We just, you know, this is beyond our control.
Thank you. Sadhu, sadhu.